But how did I come across the Sanjak? So I already said my first poster project was about the Austrian occupation regimes, but my second one, I went back from the First World War to the 19th century, because I never read the sources and memoirs of the officers who served in the occupation regimes in Serbia and Montenegro. I very often came across that they were speaking about, oh, I already know Slavia or the future, how it was called in Turkish, and because you already served there. And I asked myself, okay, when did you serve there? And there was an Austro-Hungarian presence for about 30 years in Sanjak. It's followed the Berlin Treaty in 1878. And, well, I was really surprised that no one really did research on that topic before, but it's also the treaty, because you have to go to a lot of archives, and the sources are in a lot of languages, so you need a lot of help and cooperation. And this book was published last year. And so both of these research projects are connected with that topic I'm talking about today. So I'm using also pictures I will show. They're collected in archives in Vienna, Budapest, Sarajevo, Cetinje, Belgrade, Zagreb, and in the Sanjak region. So for example, in Bethlehem, Plevin. And for my presentation, when I'm speaking about what the Austrians did in the Sanjak, I'm using documents from different administrative levels, so from the Amtsleitung in Vienna, for example, or from the Foreign Ministry, down to the lowest level of occupation administration districts. And for example, Plevin was a district. And I also include personal testimonies of the officers, so you can see I'm mostly focusing on the self-perception of the occupier, how they understood the population in the Sanjak and the occupation regime and their communities. I also include published and unpublished memoirs and newspapers from the time. So I would like to start with this picture. It is an Austro-Hungarian propaganda picture, and it's used for the war press office, the Kriegspressequartier, and it is dated with January 12, 1916. And it was taken shortly after Serbia had been occupied by Austro-Hungarian forces. The picture has an official propaganda title, and is, I quote, "Soldiers of Muslim faith among Serbian prisoners of war receive a permission to return home." And my paper deals with the political background of this example. It also brings other examples for the favorable treatment of the Muslim, Albanian, and Turkish population in occupied Montenegro and Serbia, and I'm focusing on the former Sanjak. Sanjak, which means somewhere between Novi Pazar, Jeni Pazar, and Plevne Tasnice. The opinion of the Austro-Hungarian ruling elites about the Ottoman Empire up to the beginning of the 19th century was that of an arch enemy. Out of different reasons, this attitude shifted until the end of the 19th century. During the First World War, a massive pro-Ottoman propaganda was spread over the Habsburg lands, aimed to explain the newly emerged partnership to the Habsburg population. So if you're more interested in the topic, I guess Marie Curie will publish a book or also articles on that topic in the next years. The attitude of the Austro-Hungarian military elite toward the Balkan Muslim population had shifted mainly because of two reasons, I would say, and I'm focusing on them. Besides the positive experience which was made with the Muslim population since 1878 in occupied and after 1908 annexed Bosnia and Herzegovina, and since 1879, Austria-Hungary held, due to the Berlin Treaty, a military presence in Sanjak, Novi Pazar, Jeni Pazar. This Ottoman district was neighboring Bosnia-Herzegovina in the south. So I just brought also a picture from Bosnia-Herzegovina, on which you can see that also a lot of Muslims from Bosnia-Herzegovina served the Austro-Hungarian army during the First World War. These soldiers are in the mosque praying in Sarajevo, in the Vashtashia, and they were I don't know exactly which regiment, but they were from one of those four Bosnian regiments. In the contrary to Bosnia-Herzegovina, the Ottoman administration in Sanjak remained in duty, so that's very important, because the Austrians had no possibility in Sanjak to change any law or anything, and they were not able to influence the administration. And I've got a map just to figure out, this is the how it was So in 1879, the Austrians entered Sanjak, and in 1880, the Ottoman administration reorganized the whole region, and they created a new vilayet of Kosovo. And the Austrians only sent troops to the northern part, which I marked in blue. So we have to say that the Austrians never entered that Sanjak of Novi Pazar. They had the right from the treaty, so they were just in the northern part. So to say it very simple, there was not a single Austrian soldier in the town of Novi Pazar until 1516. While the first years of Austrian presence in Sanjak were characterized by mutual mistrust between the Ottoman local ruler and the Austrian military authorities, this situation changed severely in the following years up to 1908, when the Habsburg army left. Especially for the Austrian officers, it had become clear that their interests and challenges were much more comparable with the multi-ethnic Ottoman Empire than with bordering nation states, such as Serbia and Montenegro. And if you're interested in Sanjak topics, only to make a little edge, so my book unfortunately came out only in German language, but it should be, there's a plan to publish it or translate it into Turkish, thanks to my embassy here in Turkey, so maybe 2016. But if you are now interested, Isabumi has edited a volume on the Balkan Wars, and then you can find out in the English language about the most important data about the Austrian presence. So, in 1878, the Habsburg Empire argued that they had come to rescue the Balkan Christians from Muslim suppression. In 1908, when the presence ended, Habsburg officers and politicians were afraid of that the Muslims will become the future victims in the region. The former threatened Christians, in their eyes, had become threatening Serbs. And this is just a picture from the Sanjak. It's the bridge crossing the river in Prepolje, and it's a common border guard of Turkish army, Ottoman army, and Austrian army. Besides the Sanjak experience, the attitude of Austrian policymakers and military elites towards Muslims in the Balkans and the Ottoman Empire was influenced also by the First Balkan War. The former expected Muslim victims had become victims in their eyes. The favor of the German and Hungarian-speaking public sphere rests solely with the Ottomans, while Habsburg Slavs, Czechs, and South Slavs more or less supported the nation states, Montenegro, and Serbia. So when Jennifer Keeley was in the last panel speaking about there was like one opinion, one group during the war in the United States, it was the whole comparable situation in the Habsburg Empire. In a German-speaking Marburger Zeitung, today Maribor in Slovenia, after the outbreak of the First Balkan War, it was written, I quote, every decent person in Europe sympathizes with the Turks. Means that all people living in the Habsburg Empire who are not supporting the Turks are not decent. And I'll show you a picture of one of the satirical magazines which were published in the Habsburg Empire, and it shows how Ottoman Empire was seen as an old man suffering, but this also means that, you know, if this is an old man who is suffering, it's a sympathetic image, and not that of someone who threatens. And during these critical days, following October 1912, the reaction of the Muslim population in Bosnia-Herzegovina was proved as especially loyal to the Habsburg monarchy. In the beginning of 1916, Austria-Hungary implemented occupation regimes in Serbia and Montenegro. So I've brought a little map just to figure out. I'm a military historian, a little map, so I've brought two of them. Hopefully not too much. But you can see here it's split along this thick line. So the former Sanjak was split between the occupation regime of Serbia and Montenegro. So finally it belongs to Montenegro and Prepolje and Novi Pazar to Serbia. And this picture where we marched into Plevia. You can see a Turkish flag on the right side. While the Habsburg army ruled Montenegro alone, Serbia was divided between Bulgaria and Austria-Hungary. One Habsburg military general government had its capital in Belgrade, the other one in Cetinje. Very often the army's high command sent officers to the Balkan regimes who have already experienced the region either in Bosnia-Herzegovina or in the Sanjak, and they knew the Serbo-Croatian language very often. example. The chief of staff in Cetinje was Kupka, who was before diplomatic envoy to Montenegro. And the military commander in Belgrade, Adolf von Weymann, was the last commander in Sanjak until 1908. When analyzing the documents of the Austrian Army's high command from 1915 onwards and the reports of the military governments and district commands in the region, it becomes obvious that the occupied population in Serbia and Montenegro had been treated in different ways. The differentiator was not their political attitude, for example, as they called it, Austrophile, or opponent of the Habsburg monarchy, but religion and ethnicity. From the first day of occupation, it was reported from Sassan Serbia, that's how the Austrians called it, and parts of Montenegro, that the Muslim population showed a friendly attitude toward the Habsburg conqueror. Some of the occupying officers wrote that they already personally knew a lot of local influential Muslim families in the former Sanjak region, who expressed their will to collaborate, especially in those parts of Montenegro and Serbia, which had been conquered during the First Balkan War. The Muslim population expressed their feeling of being occupied and suppressed. The army members believed this assertion all the more as the supposed Orthodox population never became Muslim friendly. In addition, for the occupation regimes, the support of reliable parts of the population seemed most important to fulfill the occupation task. So the military was forced interest in fulfilling this task. This had been exploitation of the country as much as possible, and securing peace and order in the back of the front. Another reason was that the Ottoman Empire, and so in a concluding line, the Turks and Muslims had become an ally, and this ally should not be offended. Here you can see all these pictures. It's called Refugees Are Returning to Slavia. So we also have to say that the Austrians wrote a lot about that. Also, many Muslim, Albanian, and Turkish families came back from Turkey who fled during the First Balkan War. They came back and also the Austrian occupation. Favorable treatment of the Muslim and Turkish population occurred in very many ways during the occupation of Serbia and Montenegro, very often by mercy of the Orthodox population. And I wrote only a few examples. After the Austro-Hungarian army occupied Serbia and Montenegro, there had been a strong interest in the functioning of municipal governments on the lowest level of the local administration. Due to the Serbian and Montenegrin retreat, many former heads were absent or had to be replaced by others because of their hostile attitude. In the Sanjak region, the former Muslim leaders, who had been largely replaced by Orthodox after the First Balkan War, showed their willingness to support the occupation regime. As a sign of repay, Austria-Hungary had to stick to stipulations such as to remain former heads in office. The occupation regimes were now challenged with the question either to reinstall the former Orthodox elite or to appoint influential and seemingly cooperative Muslims. At the beginning, the occupation regime ordered its subordinates in so-called New Montenegro, including Plevia, Jelopolje or Akova, Jerane, Ipe, Jakova, and Uzinje, to take care of equal treatment of all inhabitants by the local municipal governments, which de facto meant to take care of the Muslim population. So they always ordered treated to all of them the same way. And Vienna said, if any injustice occurred, so they always meant that the Orthodox population is offending the Muslim population, they should oppose sharply. Only in single cases, the local government had to be replaced, but by army members, not by Muslims. So they really tried to stick to this Hague stipulation. For a long time, this question missed a final decision. Although the Muslim population threatened the occupier to emigrate to Bosnia or to the Ottoman Empire, but not being engaged in administration. And then, afterwards, a vivid internal discussion among the highest military and civil institutions of the Habsburg Empire followed. The army's high command addressed a letter to the Minister of Foreign Affairs and argued that the orders previously given are insufficient to continue the devotion of those who had always been inclined, end of quote. In the end of February 1916, the Chief of General Staff, Hans Conrad von Herzenwolf, ended the discussion in regard to the Muslim population. He ordered that in each district where huge parts of the population were Muslims, they had to be engaged in the local government. exception was made only for those in Serbia and Montenegro, where the army handed over guns to reliable Muslims and Albanians to do police work. This was not the only kind of recruitment. It was in any case a violation of Hague to recruit occupied population for own war efforts, especially as soldiers. It concerned particularly the Muslims from Serbia and Montenegro to be incorporated into volunteer organizations or to the Ottoman army or to national legions, such as the Albanian legion. It was reported that 8,000 volunteers from the region had been engaged in Galicia or as part of the Bosniak regiments. A favorable treatment of the Muslim population also took place when the occupation regime organized daily life. For example, the occupying forces used thousands of private buildings for the accommodation of their troops. Muslim houses were the only ones which were excluded from this requisition. It was also not allowed to enter any house of a Muslim family for any Habsburg soldier. Therefore, houses of Orthodox Montenegrins and Serbs were used more often. The whole population was registered to do forced labor work. The only ones who were excluded were Muslim women. They also implemented forced sanitary measures like public bathing or delousing, and only Muslim women were excluded from that. The Austro-Hungarian representatives avoided to discuss the outcomes of such a favorable treatment, but they reported on ongoing debates among the Serbian and Montenegrin population, including the Muslims, of which group has been preferred or suppressed most. Orthodox and Muslims, or Catholic Albanians, Orthodox Muslims, as the volunteers. But in the end, the style of policy depended most on the attack of the respective commanding officer on the local level. They had plenty of rope, how using, for example, fines, which had been earmarked for humanitarian purposes. So the Austrians implemented a harsh new military laws, and if they took fines from the population, then it was called cultural purposes, and then the respective commander. So mostly a very young lieutenant in a village, he had the possibility to decide how to spend his money, and there had been some officers who gave all the money to rebuild mosques, and others gave it to, for example, Orthodox churches. Nevertheless, it was forbidden to support one ethnic or religious group exclusively. And this is really fascinating if you're reading the orders, the daily orders of the occupation government, because they are repeating, every several weeks they're repeating, you have to treat the population equal, and which means for the historian, they did not do that. So, to conclude. The examples of Southern Serbia and Montenegro were not the only ones where Austria-Hungary had stipulated different policies. For example, Albania and Ukraine were seen as occupied French states, while Muslims and Albanians were classified as loyal everywhere. So if you compare it with the other occupation regimes, favorable treatment of one group of the population was not that exceptional. And also, as in the other belligerent countries, the Hague regulation were much more seen as a guideline than perceived as a law. But what about the effects of such a policy? So did they assess their own measures? The reactions of the population's majority, Serbs and Montenegrins, was only discussed when violent resistance had already taken place. Though the policy did not change until the end of the occupation, from spring 1916 to autumn 1918, Serbia was declared as the most successful occupation regime in regard of the amount of exploited goods for the hinterland, including workforce. One famous phrase in Austro-Hungarian novel says, I quote, the land of the king killers became the land of milk and honey, end of quote. Therefore, the Austro-Hungarian officers asked why changing was successful and running the system. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. successfully pulled the conservative Hungarian offensive in 1914, the Kingdom of Serbia was in a very difficult situation. A few different cases had appeared among their troops in November 1914, although it was not until the following month that the disease broke out extensively. Food, shelter, clothing, and medical care were insufficient for the large number of troops, prisoners, and refugees. Before ending in the summer of 1915, the epidemic hit nearly 500,000 people and killed about 150,000 of them. The entry of Bulgaria into the war in October 1915 effectively doomed Serbia. The territory occupied by its units, as you will see in the picture on the map, is Cyrillic, but this is Greek. Bulgaria divided into two zones, the military inspection area of the Morava and the military inspection area of Macedonia. On the other hand, the command of Austria-Hungary issued an order of forming a military administrative area in Serbia, as Tamara said. Terror against the local population was much more severe in Bulgaria than in the Austrian occupation zone. In the occupation zone, the Bulgarian occupiers immediately began implementing Bulgarization and denationalization of the population. They started with mass deportations of adult men. They were prohibited from using Serbian personal names, their emblems, and writing in Serbian Cyrillic alphabet. Also, newborn children could only get Bulgarian names. Both the Bulgarian government changed names of streets, squares, and buildings in order to remove any trace of the existence of the Serbian state. In order to control movements of the population, the occupiers soon imposed a limited freedom of movement. While for traveling from one district to another, a passport was mandatory. Already in the first days after the occupation, the government realized how bad the situation was of the local population. The entire country was redolent of poverty. The prices of basic commodities rose off drastically. The pain of living hunger and the humiliation of standing in food lines and participating in the black market started the entire situation. As time went on, the authorities, mostly also Hungarian, had a detailed plan for the provisions of food for the urban population. Three institutions were set up for that purpose. The central office for the traffic of goods, the military intendants, and the central office for the bushes of corn. The maximum prices of goods and products were fixed by special regulations. Those of Hungarian occupation government tried to introduce certain social measures to improve the position of the most vulnerable part of the population. They established the Central Committee of Assistance to the Poor, headquartered in Belgrade. Also, it was planned that the committee would form county boards for help, to help open soap kitchens, orphanages, and distribute food to the most vulnerable parts of the population. But this support was not sufficient for the whole population in Serbia. The poor conditions of living, the irregular and inadequate diet, and the frequent stressful situations gave rise to many maladies. Health conditions were pretty bad from the beginning of 1915, and after the occupation, troops of the Central Powers were caught in an early disaster situation. War conditions led to the emergence of many diseases that were spreading very quickly, often in the form of epidemics, like cholera, spotted fever, dysentery. As the situation was alarming, measures were undertaken primarily to suppress the disease, like painted posters,